Good morning to everyone. My name is Massimo Galbiati. I'm responsible for Particle Works at Enginesoft. And the topic of today's webinar is Particle Works for ANSYS. I will start with a short introduction about the methodology moving particle simulation on which Particle Works is based. And then we will go through the main industrial applications of Particle Works, and I will explain and show live how to create a co-simulation between Particle Works and ANSYS to transfer loads from Particle Works or to read inside Particle Works the airflow field calculated from ANSYS Fluent. But let's start with a short introduction about the methodology. We are talking about moving particle simulation. Moving particle simulation is a method, a Lagrangian, deterministic Lagrangian method to solve Navier-Stokes equations, so the motion of fluids in incompressible conditions. And this methodology was born more than 20 years ago at the University of Tokyo from Professor Koshizuka. It's a particle-based methodology, so it's meshless. And this has a big benefit in terms of setup and simulation time. And the main field of application of this methodology is free surface flows and liquid sprays and liquid jets. But you can also include other physical phenomena like the generation of bubbles in oil or in liquids, or the interaction between liquids and gas or liquids and solid granular materials. I will show you some examples. One of the big benefits of this meshless methodology is the fact that you can easily handle very complex geometries without the complexity of generating the computational grid and managing the motion of the parts. That typically is done by mesh morphing, mesh regeneration, or mesh overset that is typically complex to do and also sometimes numerically unstable. The moving particle simulation is a Lagrangian one. So the main difference with respect to the finite volume CFD, that is the most common way to solve the Navier-Stokes equation, is that it's based on a Lagrangian approach. You have points that are located inside the computational domain, and these points move according to the Navier-Stokes equation. The solver calculates the velocity, pressure, temperature, and turbulence of these points along the trajectories of the points itself. The main difference is that, as I mentioned before, you don't have to generate the computational grid. Instead of having a fixed mesh, fixed grid, you have moving entities. The big benefit of this is, as I mentioned at the beginning, is the reduced setup and simulation time. And this means that you use this methodology even at the early stages of the design process to drive the design of your system by doing simulation in a short time. That means in many cases, you are able to reduce the setup and computational time from weeks, that is typically what is needed for finite volume CFD, from weeks to few days to set up and run a simulation. And this is mainly due to the fact that in the process that you typically build, where you typically build the mesh generation, first of all, the fluid volume and the mesh generation, this part is totally removed from the process when you work with moving particle simulation and Particle Works. You basically read the CAD as is, you read the solid parts, you don't even need to extract the fluid volume. Then you continue as usual with the boundary condition, physical properties, settings, and numerical settings, and then you start the simulation. And again, the process is compressed, is accelerated by the use of GPU calculation. Particle Works can run both on multi-core and on GPU, and this gives a great advantage in terms of computational time. Just to give you a rough idea, one GPU NVIDIA B100 is equivalent to about 64 cores. This gives you an idea of the speed of this kind of hardware. If we talk about industrial applications, for sure one of the main field of application is oil splashing and lubrication analysis of any kind, forced lubrication also of gears, bearings, and transmissions. And the benefit of using this kind of methodology is that in these systems, the geometrical complexity is the main bottleneck for standard CFD, for finite volume CFD. And this bottleneck is totally removed by the meshless nature of particle works. Engine lubrication and piston cooling. So lubrication, that means oil distribution in the system, but also heat transfer, if we talk about piston cooling. Gradability analysis, that is the analysis of how much you can tilt the engine. And this is also related to the simulation of oil sump aeration. What happens if you tilt the engine? Will the pump pick oil or will pick a mixture of oil and air? This is one of the typical questions that can be answered by particle works. E-drives cooling, so internal combustion engines, but also electric engines, electric motors. And again, we talk about cooling, oil distribution and cooling efficiency. If we talk about water, water management for vehicles like wading, rain simulation, but also mud and snow simulation. We can also simulate water turbines like Pelton and Banky turbines. I will show you an example. And also highly viscous flows, non-Newtonian fluids, processes related to mixing, pouring of fluids, filling of bottles and packages, washing processes, for example, dishwashers or washing machines. These are some of the main industrial application of this kind of methodology. And I just want to highlight that some of these applications are interconnected, like the simulation of transmissions and the e-motors in recent applications like electric axles or similar transmissions, the two kinds of simulation, lubrication and cooling, go hand in hand. Just to show you some of the results, but also some of the validations that we have done and our customers have done. This comes from Comer Industries. This is a validation that was done between a model, particle works model. The aim is to evaluate the lubrication of these bearings. And in this case, you see very good lubrication in this area of this intermediate bearing and poor lubrication or no lubrication at all at the top. And you see the same kind of behavior from the clear case. So the methodology has been validated by several companies in this sector. And we also have best practice that can be applied to this kind of simulation. You see the comparison both where you have good lubrication and also the capability to predict poor lubrication in a specific operating condition and in a specific area of the system. And being able to predict this kind of critical condition at the early stages of the design obviously gives a big advantage in terms of reduction of cost and time to solve these kind of issues. Engine, lubrication, gradability, oil aeration. There's a specific model I mentioned before about the bubble generation in the oil sump due to the rupture of the free surface due to the action of the solid body like gears or the crankshaft in this case, or due to the interaction between droplets or jet breaking the free surface and creating air entrainment and bubbles. If we talk about electric motors. Particle works has been used in the simulation of the oil flow inside the rotor shaft to calculate the oil flow rate distribution, to calculate the air and oil flow in the complete system, so in the electric motor. And from this kind of simulation, what you can calculate is also the heat transfer distribution on the surfaces of the windings, mainly on the windings. And this is the starting point to predict the windings temperature. And the transfer from the particle work simulation, from the heat transfer coefficient calculation and the windings temperature calculation is done by coupling typically particle works with an FEA software. This is the process that we usually apply. We run the CFD analysis, the oil flow and the airflow analysis inside particle works. We take the HTC distribution on the walls of the system, and then we map the HTC on a thermal FEA model, and we run the temperature calculation in the FEA model. So we decouple the fluid analysis from the thermal analysis, and this is mainly due to the fact that the fluid flow time scale is much, much shorter than the temperature time scale. The fluid flow time scale is in the range of few seconds. The temperature time scale it's in the scale of minutes or in some cases hours. That's why by decoupling the two simulations, you make the simulation process faster. And I will show you how to do this inside ANSYS. If we change the kind of fluid and we talk about water, this is an example of wading simulation, and you also see the coupling between particle works and multi-body analysis to take into account the real motion of the vehicle in this case, but the same can be done for other systems if the dynamic behavior of the object is relevant. This is from the food and beverage industry, highly non-Newtonian fluid, this chocolate coating process. And in this case, for consumer products or for food, you might have also solid material, solid granular material. And in particle works, you have a DEM solver, discrete element method, that is available inside particle works. And this means that you can easily couple the fluid flow analysis with the granular flow analysis. Something similar from the consumer products. This is detergent flow, the comparison of two shapes of the bottle. Again, non-Newtonian fluids. And yes, this is the end of the example. We start talking about the coupling with ANSYS, and I will show you how to do the coupling with ANSYS. If we go back to the example about the transfer of information from the fluid flow analysis to the FEA analysis to calculate the temperature of the e-motor, but the same can be done for a piston. In this case, we need the fluid flow analysis, the oil flow analysis, and this is done with particle works. And then we need a fast simulation with a steady state thermal analysis, and this is done with FEA. This is particularly simple. This can be done actually with any kind of FEA. We have coupled particle works with several kinds of FEA software, but this is particularly easy and simple with ANSYS because of the particle works for ANSYS interface. This is available inside ANSYS Workbench. It's just an extension of the ANSYS Workbench environment, and it makes very simple to transfer pressure distribution and heat transfer coefficient. The idea is that what you do is to calculate the fluid velocity and the pressure from the particle works analysis, and then inside particle works you can easily map the distribution of pressure from the fluid flow analysis onto the surfaces of the system. And this can be done both in a transient way or by averaging the pressure or the HTC distribution in order to have one single mapping file that can be transferred to the FEA model. And the same after running the FEA simulation, after running the CFD simulation, you can then transfer and run both again a steady state or a transient simulation inside the ANSYS environment. This is a pressure distribution transferred through ANSYS and the stress and the deformation on the baffle inside the tank. And I will show you in a few minutes this second example that is the heat transfer coefficient calculated by particle works and mapped on the piston, on the model of the piston, of the FEA model of the piston. I can just give you also a few slides about the second kind of interaction between the ANSYS environment, ANSYS software, and particle works. In this case, the first model is the ANSYS Fluent simulation. The aim of this kind of simulation is to calculate the airflow field and then to transfer the airflow field, the 3D velocity components distribution from ANSYS Fluent to particle works. So ANSYS Fluent calculates the air and particle works calculates the liquid. To let you understand, and this is again feasible from inside ANSYS Workbench by coupling, by sharing the geometry between Fluent and Particle Works and by reading the Fluent airflow field inside Particle Works. And just to give you an idea, this is one example, rain interaction with a vehicle. In background, you don't see, but there is the aerodynamic field calculated from ANSYS Fluent, and it affects the trajectory of the water of the rain droplets on the surface of the car. This is clearly visible in this area, and in this area, the drag effect of the air is applied on the particles, on the water particles. And the same can be done with a closed system in a closed environment like a gearbox. In this case, the gear is not in contact with oil, and the motion of oil is due to the air motion produced by the gear. And here you see the effect of different rotational speed, increasing the rotational speed, also the effect on the oil flow increases. So this kind of velocity flow input can be easily done with any kind of system. So let's switch to the ANSYS Workbench environment to show you how this can be done. For those who know ANSYS, this is the Workbench environment where you have all the ANSYS software available. In order to add the Particle Works for ANSYS extension, you just have to install the extension. That is an extension file that is provided. It's basically an executable. You link to the ANSYS Workbench, then the extension is available under the Extension Manager, Particle Works for ANSYS, and you will be able to drag and drop the Particle Works simulation process inside Workbench. Now, I already prepared one geometry. So the steps are geometry definition, and this can be done with space claim. In this case, we are talking about a piston, and we want to simulate the oil flow inside the gallery of this piston to calculate the cooling efficiency. So we start from space claim. We then automatically open Particle Works and read the geometry inside Particle Works. So you can start Particle Works from the ANSYS Workbench environment, and I will not show you how to set up the entire model, but I will show you the main steps to generate a model and to run a simulation inside Particle Works. In this project, we have one piston What we have done is to import, to read only the solid parts, for example, the crankshaft, the cylinder, the nozzle, that is this small object, and we have defined an inflow, an oil inflow located just at the exit of the nozzle. On the inflow, we apply the oil properties, that is density, mainly density and viscosity, but you also have to apply surface tension and the thermal properties if you are interested in the heat transfer calculation. And we have to specify the flow rate or the velocity, 10 meters per second in this case. And you can also specify the temperature if you want to calculate the heat transfer explicitly and predict also the oil temperature. We have the piston at the top, and on the piston wall we have applied the constant initial temperature of 400 degrees C. So the software will calculate the heat transfer between 85 degrees of the oil and 400 of the piston. The motion is specified quite easily because you associate the law of motion to the piston in this case, but also to the other objects. And you have a preview that shows you how the objects move. So as you see, we don't have any fluid volume, we don't have any computational grid, we just have solid bodies and we apply all the properties to the solid bodies. In this case, we already solved the flow, and I show you what happens. So the injection starts from this point. You see the particles. In this case, the particle size is 0.5 millimeters. So this is one of the main information that you have to provide during the setup of the simulation, the particle size. And this is the oil jet entering the gallery from one side, traveling inside the gallery, and then going out on the other side. And we can also see an animation of the flow. It is quite fast, but it gives you an idea of what happens. Now, we have, obviously, you can color the particles with the variables like velocity, temperature, and pressure. In this case, we have the HTC distribution. And what we want to do is to map the heat transfer coefficient from the particles onto the surfaces of the system to transfer this kind of distribution to ANSYS. So what we do is, first of all, to select the surface on which we want to map. This is the gray surface that you see here. We have to associate the surface to the moving object, that is the piston, so that it's correctly located inside the gallery. And we will basically interpolate information from the particles onto the mesh that you see here. This is a simple STL file. We want to calculate the average, not the instantaneous value. And we enable the output to a CSV file. And this is the output file that will then be read by ANSYS. We execute the post-processing. And we are now able to see the HTC distribution on the surface. This is the surface that we read and the HTC distribution that we are now ready to export to ANSYS. So we can go back to the ANSYS environment. We just have to tell the software where the map is located. So we just go to the model, to the Particle Works model. Under the mapping directory, we have this CSV file that is also editable. This is the file and this is the surface piston. SDL where we have to apply the map. We update, and now we are ready to link the particleworks process to the steady state thermal simulation inside ENSYS. So first of all, we share the geometry, then we share the map, and we open the ANSYS model. We don't need to reread the geometry, everything will be there, and we will see that the extension, the particleworks for ANSYS extension, enables a new menu inside ANSYS Mechanical that is this particleworks load. So the model is now opening. And what we will do is to import the convection coefficients, apply the temperature. The temperature will automatically be read from the particleworks model. So we will see the same temperature that we have applied on the piston walls. And we will just have to specify the surfaces where the interpolation has to be done. So this is again the same geometry. We select the steady state thermal analysis, we go to the particle works load, and we import the map in one click. Now we have to specify where this imported convection is applied. First of all, we need to generate the mesh. We specify the mesh size, 1 millimeter, and we generate the mesh. This is necessary to be able to interpolate the data from the particleworks results to the ENSYS mesh. While it's working, I can explain what we will do. We will associate the surfaces to the imported load. We will associate the external surfaces to a second boundary condition, that is the temperature on the walls, on the external walls. Just let me cut the piston to look inside and be able to apply the transfer coefficient on the gallery, that is these two surfaces. So we just need to select the object, select the surfaces, and apply. So on the red surface, we will see the HTC distribution. And now we apply the temperature boundary condition on all the other surfaces. As you see, we already have the right value, 400 degrees C, that is the same that we applied before. And now we just have to select all the surfaces apart from the gallery. So we remove the gallery. All the red surfaces have a fixed temperature and the gallery has the HTC distribution. We can read the HTC distribution. And this is what you see. This is the same. Let me see if I can cut along a different plane. So we have all we need to start the simulation. I just need to define the substeps for the calculation. And we want just to calculate the temperature of the system. So we should be ready to solve, and we just have to wait for the solution. Okay, while it's working, I try to answer some of the questions. Yes, one question about the extraction of the fluid volume. Yes, you don't need to extract the fluid volume, you just need the solid parts. Okay, let's see. There is one question about the failure of particle generation if the domain is not closed. Yes, obviously you have to make the domain watertight. If the domain is not watertight, you have leakages, so the particles will go out of the casing, for example, of the gearbox or of the engine. Okay, we have the solution. So just to show you that we have the temperature distribution according to the HTC that we read and we imported, and this is what I wanted to show you. So the transfer of HTC from Particle Works to ENSYS and the thermal solution. Okay, let me go back to the questions. I think we have 10, 15 minutes, so I can try to answer to some of these. Let me see where they are. Yes, one question about air simulation. One question about air simulation, and I think the best way is to use this kind of slide to show the different ways you have to simulate a particle to simulate air inside Particle Works. So we basically have three levels and three ways of simulating air inside Particle Works. The first one that I mentioned before is by reading the velocity field, importing the velocity field from any CFD solver. Could be Fluent, could be CFX or StarCCM or OpenFOAM, any velocity field from CFD solvers, both steady state and transient, can be read. And in this case, what you do is to read the velocity field, and you will have the effect of the airflow on the liquid phase, not the effect of the liquid phase on the airflow. And this is, for example, acceptable if you want to simulate rain on a vehicle and you want to account for the external aerodynamics effect. The second level is an embedded finite volume solver that will be available from the next version of Particle Works in June, version 7. It's an internal solver based on a Cartesian grid. So this means that you can easily simulate also moving parts. And in this case, you will be able to account for the two-way coupling between air and liquid. And the third step, that is the most expensive in terms of computational time, is the two-phase flow using MPS method. That means that you discretize both the air or the gas and the liquid with particles. And again, also in this case, you have a two-way coupling between the two phases. We have some other questions. Let me pick some of them. Yes, regarding the geometry, you need to import STL files of the solid objects. You don't need to read the surfaces. You don't need to have inner and outer surfaces, you just read the body. When instead you do the mapping, you can do the mapping directly on the existing models inside the Particle Works project, or you can read after the simulation a second STL file that could be finer to especially to do the mapping. Just to give you an idea, in this case where we have the pressure distribution on a Pelton turbine, the mapping, the simulation was done on using a coarser definition of the geometry. So the fluid flow analysis was done on a coarser geometry, and then the mapping was done on a finer geometry, surface only, that was read after the end of the simulation. Regarding the piston cooling examples, or there is one question about how many engine cycles you need to simulate to reach a steady state. Typically for internal combustion engine, what we have seen is that after 25, 30 strokes cycles, you have a steady oil volume inside the stable oil volume inside the gallery, and you have stable heat transfer values. Someone asks about gearbox examples and simulation. We have several. Just to give you an idea, we have several applications and examples on the Particle Works Europe website under case studies. You will find plenty of examples from several companies like GKN Driveline, like BorgWarner, like Comer Industries. We have a couple of examples. One is, I think it's probably the most interesting one, about validation of oil splashing and lubrication, is this one from Comer Industries. If you read this paper, you will find also a table with the comparison of six operating conditions of the gearbox and the matching between the experimental data and the numerical results. There is one question about how is the data transfer from meshless to mesh approach. So as I showed you before, when you have the particle solution, the all the variables like pressure and HTC are calculated on the particles. Then this kind of information is first of all transferred from the particle to the walls, and this is done internally by Particle Works, from particles to the STL file, and then the interpolation from the STL file on which the mapping is done inside Particle Works, and the transfer to the FEA is done by the FEA solver. So the interpolation is done by ENSYS in this case. I'm going through the questions to try to answer to all of you. Yes, regarding non-Newtonian fluids, you can define, there are predefined laws, viscosity laws, that you can use. Let me see if I can show you. This is the fluid manager definition, the fluid physical property manager inside Particle Works. This is the definition of the oil properties. So you have the density, in this case it's a constant value, the viscosity, but you can enable non-Newtonian fluids by using Bingham power law cross Arrhenius, or you can enter your own formulation using a tabular way, or defining your own user function in JavaScript. Small holes in the CAD, obviously you have to remove small holes. Small holes in the CAD are visible to the particles if the holes are larger than the particles. So in this case, for example, the particle size is 0.5 millimeters. It means that any small hole that is smaller than the particle size, it's not a problem. Instead, a 1 millimeter hole becomes a leakage of oil in the system. Regarding the oil through the upstream bearing, I think it refers to this animation again. The oil is splashed from the bottom, and then it goes through laterally along the axis of the system because the particle size is quite small. So the flow through the bearing is explicitly calculated because the dimension of the particle in this case was in the range of 0.7 millimeter. So the solver was able to capture the flow through between one sphere and the other. I think I answered or tried to answer all the questions. Particle size, there is one question about how is the particle size defined, for example, water or oil. So this is just a number that you input when you define the model. You have to specify the particle size. So in this wizard, you basically have to read the geometry, apply the material properties to the objects, and then you have to specify the particle size. And the particle size is one single value. You can have several fluids, but they are all discretized by the same particle size. You can have water, oil, air in the same simulation, and they will all be 0.5 millimeter particles. And one important aspect is that the particle size affects the accuracy of the calculation and obviously the computational time. Convergence and momentum and energy conservation, mass conservation. So the mass conservation is guaranteed by the number of particles. Every particle is basically a certain volume or mass of fluid, and you can plot and check the number of particles in the system. In this case, we have an open system with an inflow, so the number of particles is zero at the beginning and it grows. If you have a closed system, you would see a constant number of particles, that means a constant mass in the system. So unless you have leakages from the casing of your gearbox, the mass conservation is guaranteed by the number of particles conservation. And if you respect the best practice for the time step calculation, this is automatically guaranteed. Can you have air particles in 6.2? Yes, you can have air particles. This example was run not with 6.2, but with 6.1 a couple of years ago. We have a public paper. You just have to fill the system with air particles. What you do in this case, if you look at this at the initial condition of this simulation, the electric motor volume is filled with particles. These are the pink particles, it's air, and the colored particles injected from the top, this is oil particles. So you just have to create a fill, fill the entire space with air particles, with air properties, and then you inject oil from other areas. Or you can partially fill the system with air, for example, the top part and the bottom part with another fluid. Python and the journal file, yes, you can from version 7 the entire simulation process can be automatically defined using a Python script. That means that the starting from scratch, the project generation, the simulation setup, and the run and also the post-processing can be automatically done by Python scripting. And there is one question about thermal results and sensitivity to boundary layer treatment. Yes, this is a complex question. Particle Works calculates the HTC based on the based on a correlation. The idea is that I think I have one slide here. The idea is that even if you don't solve the energy equation, you have correlations that are calculated based on the Reynolds and Prandtl number, and based on this correlation that are available inside Particle Works but can also be user defined, the software calculates locally Reynolds and Nusselt. Obviously with particle methods you cannot explicitly solve the boundary layer. This is not the aim of this kind of simulation. We have some validation cases. Again, on the website, we have validation cases about the calculation of temperature and calculation of HTC for a piston cooling case. So my suggestion is to contact me if you have any further questions, or to go to the particleworkseurope.com website. Under case studies, you will find examples about lubrication, piston cooling and temperature, validation, and many other examples. I thank you for your time and for the questions. If you have any question, you can directly email, send me an email to this address that you find here. Thank you very much and have a nice day.